great music created in the 80s. Why are we still listening to music from the 60s? In a moment, I want to introduce you to Michael Hurd. He's a PhD. He's the author of a book that's going to yank your chain. It's Grow Up America, Learning to Live the Happy, Responsible Life. And please keep in mind that responsible means you can't blame somebody else for your pile, huh? Michael Hurd is a PhD, author of Grow Up America, Learning to Live Happy, Responsible Lives. Please welcome Dr. Hurd on board. Can I call you Mike?
Yeah, that's just fine.
Hey, welcome to the show, and thanks for being with me.
Thank you.
Growing up, grow up and stop suing all over, over spilled
exactly.
coffee and so on. What's the message here? Because as I go through your book, I mean, you say a lot of different things, a lot of most of which I agree with, by the way.
Well, good. I'm glad. Let me give you some background. I was trained as a psychotherapist about 20 years ago, and pretty much everything I'm writing in my book, Grow Up America, and my first book, too, called Effective Therapy, and I have a new booklet out called Human Relationships in Plain English, pretty much everything I'm writing is the exact opposite of what I was taught. I was taught, training to be a psychologist, that people are largely victims. They're victims of their childhood, they're victims of their parents, they're victims of their brain physiology, all kinds of elaborate things. And actually, people are victims sometimes, but most of the time they're not. And the growing up process, especially in today's culture, is coming to terms with the fact that we all make our choices. Now, we don't always make conscious choices. We don't set out always to do stupid things or dumb things. But if in the final analysis we do make a mistake in our lives, the thing that's in our self-interest to do and that is mentally healthy to do, and I would argue moral to do, is to take responsibility for the fact and stop thinking in terms of the passive voice, you know, this was done to me or this didn't get done, and start thinking in terms of the active voice. What did I do wrong? My child is diagnosed with ADD, attention deficit disorder. Could my child be doing something wrong? Could I be sending him wrong messages? Let's just stop looking at brain physiology and, you know, childhood psychology and things like that to excuse everything away. And I learned, I mean, I had to become, it's ironic, I had to become a therapist to learn that most of what I was taught in graduate school was mistaken. And the way that I learned that, I mean, I believed everything I was taught in graduate school and thought it was scientific and made sense, but, you know, you talk to real people day in and day out about their real lives for years on end, and you get a whole different picture of what reality is.
Let me ask you, I almost said loaded, but it's not a loaded question because it's not going to explode on you.
Okay.
It may come back on me because of the very same national sympathy factor that you're talking about. What is Rush Limbaugh a victim of?
Well, okay, that's a great question. Now, I don't know Rush Limbaugh personally, obviously, and I hate psychologists who come on the line and go on the shows and things and, you know, talk about the psychology of someone they don't even know personally. Rush Limbaugh obviously made a mistake. And
Wait, careful now. What is the difference between a mistake and a bad choice?
Essentially the same thing.
Okay. I'm only striving for clarity, doctor. Okay.
He made a bad choice. I mean, he shouldn't go around talking about how, you know, it's not good to abuse drugs. I mean, not that that's the center of his show, but he obviously makes that position clear when he's knowingly doing it himself. But this is a man who he must have been dishonest with himself. And this is the key part of my answer to your question. I like Rush Limbaugh. I like most of his ideas, and I agree with an awful lot that he says. And I think he's done.
Well, hold on a minute. Let me ask you a question here, and don't lose your train of thought.
Okay.
You said you like him. What is the difference between liking him and respecting him?
Well, let me say why I like him first. I like him and I respect him because he emphasizes a lot of the things I emphasize and I believe in, such as personal responsibility. But one thing that I never did like about Rush Limbaugh was that he didn't seem to show much of a respect for psychology or the need to introspect or the need for people to know what's going on inside of themselves. And not that I expect the man to be a psychologist, but he always seemed to sort of denigrate that, like most conservatives tend to, in my experience.
Okay. Now,
and I think he paid a price for that idea because
okay, hold on.
Respected more.
I don't want to break your train of thought. And as
okay.
I said, This is not an adversarial show, so, and I think you're doing great because you're answering a lot of question marks for me.
Mm-hmm.
I want to come back to his national audience. I've taken a lot of heat for asking these questions. I've taken a lot of heat for saying that Rush Limbaugh let a lot of people down, that he had a greater responsibility because he was the spearhead.
Mm-hmm.
What is there about the American people, this fan base, if you will, who instantly will turn on the messenger for even asking the question, least of all delivering the message?
What do you mean here by turn on the messenger?
Well, I called Rush Limbaugh what he was, plain and simple, a junkie. Okay. Now,
fair enough.
It's not a nice word, and we know all the negative aspects it brings with it.
Yeah.
But the thought of Rush Limbaugh being referred to as a junkie was so devastating to some people that I've even lost an affiliate over the matter.
Oh, wow.
Okay? But the bottom line is, now, I don't know what you know about me. I'm a first-generation American. I'm as brown as mahogany furniture. I'm a former civil rights activist. I'm a first-generation American. And I espouse conservative values because I believe America works. I was never raised. I'm 63 years old yesterday. When I heard the word nigger, I went to the dictionary. I think I was 13 or 12.
Uh-huh.
And back then, the definition of the N-word was a person of low character and self-esteem. PC has since changed it. But when I say to you that I was never raised to be a nigger, that's exactly what I'm saying. So these were values that have paid off for me. They've paid off for my children. They're paying off for my grandchildren. And these are values that I sink or swim by. And Rush Limbaugh was the lighthouse. Now, to challenge, to say that he had a greater responsibility to the people who believed in him, to the people who took heat for listening to his message and spreading his message, and then to deny that because the fact that Rush Limbaugh could be a junkie is so devastating to you, there's a lot of backlash there.
Well, I would say he betrayed himself, and in the process, he betrayed a lot of people.
Indeed.
Who looked up to him.
Indeed. Dr. Hurd, let me ask you to, Michael, let me ask you to hold a moment, and we'll come right back to you. We're going to get into some really excellent points that Michael Hurd, PhD, makes in his book, Grow Up America, Learning to Live the Happy and Responsible Life. Takes a lot of work, and you're going to be held accountable for what you do, but you do feel good on the weekend. I'm Ken.
The Ken Hamblin Show, making liberals eat their lies.
Tighten up on that bass now. Tighten it up. Yeah. Now let that guitar fall in.
Okay, we're back. I'm in a little bit of trouble with you, Dr. Hurd, and I'll tell you why. I want to continue to talk to you here, and we've only got a couple of minutes. So what I want to do is to be able to call you back.
Sure.
Okay, and we'll be able to do that. Okay, let's not waste the time we have, and I don't want to fixate on Rush Limbaugh. He was just a big figurehead for me to talk about taking responsibility.
Right.
Because essentially that's what you're talking about.
I don't judge his mistake to have been an honest one because he knew what he was doing.
Okay.
It was a bad choice. Yeah, people don't want to hear it. He is a junkie. That's why he's in a rehab program right now. I think the reason people get upset when they hear you say that is they feel like he was more than a junkie. He's a man who advocated ideas they believed in. He did it with humor and eloquence. And, you know, they don't want to accept that there's this other side to him, but there is this other side to him, and they got to face that reality.
The irony is I've taken heat also for calling for the full, complete, and total legalization of all drugs, which falls into many things that you've written about, not the drugs, but we are a nation that takes a position or a belief that the government is responsible for us from cradle to grave. Thus, it is the government's job to protect me from myself and my burning desire to indulge in something recreational and illegal.
Yeah.
And I'm saying, you know, take responsibility and do those things or suffer the consequences.
Absolutely.
All right. Now, you talk about stress busting. Everybody's got stress. Let me hear you touch on that, please.
All right. Well, I emphasize in my book, as anyone who reads it will see, the themes of reality and self-responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And the best way, on the surface, of course, the way to avoid stress is to run away from reality. That's why sometimes people abuse drugs, or that's why they do things that aren't as bad or as unhealthy as that, but still aren't the greatest things in the world.
But that would be
the TV, whatever.
That would be taking drugs or alcoholism would be the extreme. I think we have a greater percentage of people dealing in on a level of mini denial that would involve shifting the blame more so than indulging in drugs, wouldn't don't we?
That's right. In psychology, we sometimes talk about defense mechanisms, and shifting the blame is kind of a defense mechanism. And all that means in plain English is you don't want to face something, you don't want to face the fact that you made a wrong choice, that you made a bad choice in your own life, because somehow that's a catastrophe. But the attitude I encourage, in a way, I encourage people to be easier on themselves, to tell themselves, look, if you made a mistake, don't beat up on yourself, forgive yourself, move on, but make sure you learn from the mistake, and don't pretend that anyone else did it or anyone did it to you. Don't pretend your brain physiology made you do it, or society made you do it, or President Bush made you do it for not funding your program enough, or whatever the ridiculous thing is. And that's where a lot of people in this country are caught in that. They don't know which way to go. It comes out politically, it comes out psychologically. They're really mixed. I don't think we're totally to a cradle to grave mindset yet, but we're drifting towards it. And you know, that's the basic guiding premise of both political parties now. That the Democrats, absolutely and without equivocation, especially with Howard Dean comes on the scene here as the nominee. But really, let's face it, President Bush and the Republicans are doing as much to it. We'll probably get the welfare state more advanced under their rule than under the Democrats.
Doesn't common sense tell us that it's impossible? It's like stuffing toothpaste back into the tube for Republicans to be better liberal socialist giveawayers than the Democrats are?
I think that, yes, but I think it's guilt. I think that most Republicans in office anyway feel guilty. They don't know how to handle the fact that they're the majority. I mean, you get the Democrats in there, and they don't blink, and they say, we're going to do this. I mean, they have their euphemisms for it, but they're going to nationalize health care. They're going to do this. That, now, they tend to not get away with it all the time because the Republicans start to grow a spine when they're in the minority, but they don't yet know how to be a majority.
All right, collectively across the nation, when you look at the things that people do, and when we come back, I want to touch on Chapter 10, where you say stupid things that we learn from ignorant adults.
Exactly.
But we'll get to that in a moment.
We don't have time for
No. We'll come back to it. Here's what I want to... Whatever happened to our national collective sense of common sense?
I think that a lot of the blame goes to our public school system, but more fundamental than that, what the teachers who teach in the public school system are taught, and the ideas that a lot of us get from people in my profession included, from the media, from psychologists, from our so-called leaders, they undercut our confidence in our minds, you know, in our ability to make judgments. I talk about this in the book, too, and I know you talk about this on the show.
Yeah.
You know, this is the age of non-judgmentalism. We can't...
Well, I know.
That's correct.
That's impossible. How can you... What do you mean? You know, I'll have people call and say, well, you know, we shouldn't judge anyone.
Oh, I know.
That's an absurdity. Hold on. The hourglass has got us, and we'll come back to you. Grow Up America. I think Michael J. Hurd, Ph.D., is an important man to hear from. It's a good book. Pick it up. I'm Ken.
The Ken Hamblin Show, where free speech is the order of the day.
He's the black Avenger who stands up for sure he does look good in tights.
Okay, we're back. And in a moment, I welcome back to the show Michael Hurd and his book, Grow Up America. And I'm sure you can pick this up in all better bookstores. Okay, the book, Grow Up America, the author, Michael J. Hurd, Ph.D., Learning to Live the Happy, Responsible Life. And Mike, Chapter 10, Stupid Things or Ideas That Kids Learn from Ignorant Adults.
Right. the essence of the stupid ideas that we are all taught today to some degree is this idea that we shouldn't judge. I correct my therapy clients, my therapy patients, regularly when they make a comment, you know, talking about some personal conflict. They say, well, I shouldn't judge. And I always say, stop. If you have emotions, you judge. Your feelings and your emotions are just automatic judgments. It's just part of being human that you feel them. Now, just because you have that emotional judgment doesn't mean it's valid or it's rational or it's correct. And all of us have a responsibility, most of all, to ourselves to assess, to use reason, to look at facts, to be logical, to use common sense, and assess in various situations what makes sense and what doesn't. And the problem is, if you teach kids that they shouldn't be judgmental, then what happens is they stop using their thinking caps. They stop using their thinking and reasoning abilities, but they're still left with emotions. So that's one of the ironies of today's age. It's the age of non-judgmentalism.
All right, let me ask you this.
People are more judgmental than they've ever been.
Okay, but here's an example. For instance, there was this kid that I grew up with in Brooklyn. His name was Sonny, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Sonny was a known car thief. And why would I get into a motor car on a hot Brooklyn summer night with Sonny when he rode by in a shiny convertible? At that point, I have to use my own judgment about Sonny. I have
That's
to come
right.
to a conclusion. This guy is headed for the jailhouse.
Exactly.
I don't want to be part of this. That's a judgment call about whether or not I'm the passenger in the seat when NYPD pulls the vehicle down.
Right. We couldn't get through the day without making judgments about people, about things, about events in our lives. We couldn't survive a day on a desert island if we didn't make judgments.
So the national psyche supports lying to ourselves?
The national psyche. Well, you mean the dominant cultural attitude.
Yeah,
today.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, not explicitly. If you ask someone, do you support lying to yourself? No. I mean, in principle, anyone would disagree with that. But that's the end result.
Okay.
We're kidding ourselves if we think that we can escape judgment. We cannot escape the responsibility to judge.
John Dewey, tell me why have American public schools taken to his philosophy?
Well, it's more than public schools. It's really any system of education whereby the conformity to the group or the socializing aspect of human relationships is put above the need of the individual mind to learn. I'm a big fan. I'm not a huge expert on, but I've read some and seen in practice some of Maria Montessori's methods.
Mm-hmm.
And her methods, as I understand them, are, and they're not just for genius kids, by the way, they're for most kids, or just about all kids can learn this way, is to emphasize the importance of the individual mind learning at his or her own pace. Now, on the surface, some people think this is kind of a hippie approach, if it feels good, do it, but that's not what Montessori is. Each child is held responsible for developing his mind to the greatest extent possible, but not having to worry so much about the group or keeping up with the group. Now, the problem is with education generally, but most of all in public education, the idea is to teach conformity and to have everyone sort of become the average. And really, I mean, a state-funded school, the very concept of a state-funded school, people don't want to face this, but it's the truth, is to turn kids into good little citizens. Now, we don't do it like they did it in communist Russia or Germany, but that still is the ultimate incentive of
okay.
a school system
and,
funded by the government.
And Alvin Toffler wrote about that in his book Future Shock.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote that the whole concept of the classroom, the end of period bell, was designed to prepare us for life in the factory.
Right.
Okay? But that's not necessarily bad, because the factory now can be substituted for the workplace. And when you look at the whole concept of laissez-faire, if it feels good, do it thinking, we now have generations of young people who believe that the values of the playground, the values of the street, ought to be accepted when they walk into corporate America looking for a job.
Right, right. That's the other thing I talk about in the book, of course, a sense of entitlement. That's part of the national psyche, too, if you will.
I'm looking at page 120. One 1 plus 1 equals whatever you feel like.
Right.
And you say, you talk about the child who should be able to feel the psychological rewards of competence and success without having to do any work.
Right. Well, the common argument is that if you're too hard on kids or too judgmental with them about correcting them, that's not good for their self-esteem.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing that I say in the book is the very essence of self-esteem is confidence in your mind and your mind's ability to figure out 1 plus 1 equals 2 and also much more complex things. And you don't do a child's self-esteem or self-confidence any favors by lying to him. If he says 1 plus 1 equals 3, you say, no, Johnny, that's incorrect. It's 1 plus 1 equals 2.
Mm-hmm.
Now, at this point, I don't think anyone disputes it with 1 plus 1, but I use that phrase.
Well, let's use something more devastating. Let's deal with the stupid things aspect and things like Ebonics.
Yes.
There is a classic example. Based on a very selfish foundation, educators in Oakland seeking to acquire additional government monies based on the notion that street dialogue or argo was another language,
right,
compared to Hispanic Americans receiving, speaking Spanish.
Right. That's the kind of policy that happens when you have supposedly serious-minded, intellectual people, politicians, authorities, people we're supposed to rely on and trust, falling for the view that everything is equal, everything is relative, that you can't say that one form of culture or society or way of doing things is objectively superior to another. Now, when some of your listeners, when they hear that phrase, their hair might stand on end because they think I'm saying that there's a superior race. Absolutely not. The only absolute that I see is that there's individuals, and individuals can use their reasoning minds or not. And I don't care what race or culture you come from. Everyone has a capacity to do that, unless there's something wrong with their brains or they're brain dead or something.
Or they're in denial and they're big-time liars and whatever else. Now, let me, I would be less than honest and ethical with you if I didn't tell you that I love starting rows at dinner parties.
I bet you do.
And you know the best way to do it, the biggest, most succulent piece of bait you can throw on the table,
uh-huh,
is to ask whether or not all cultures are equal. You and I think you would agree with me.
Oh,
And of course, when people get hooked and sucked into that, you've got them on they've taken the fly, and you ask them, okay, if your child is sick, would you take them to a practitioner of Santeria or Voodoo, or would you want access to the Mayo Clinic or Walter Reed?
Exactly.
Then everybody goes to a whole level of shorting out. Mike, we're out of time. Listen, it's an excellent book. I'm glad to have had an opportunity to talk with you, and I hope people use a little common sense and pick it up. Grow up, America.
Can I mention my website real quickly?
You'd offend me if you didn't. That's why you're here, to tell people about how to get your book. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, of course, you can go to Amazon.com or the bookstore, but you can also get it at my website, drhurd.com. That's drhurd.com. And I have a column there called The Daily Dose of Reason,
mm-hmm,
with an article on the news of the day or some psychological issue. If you like the book, you'll love The Daily Dose of Reason, and your listeners should check that out every day.
Okay. I don't know if you have any kind of an alert list for what you're doing. Do you?
You mean like a sign-up list?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we do. And you can do that right at the website.
Okay. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to give you back to Miss Kelly. And I'd like you, anything that you think we might be interested, to send our way, okay?
Very good. Thank you, Ken.
No, thank you for an excellent book, Grow Up America, Learning to Live the Happy, Responsible Life, Michael J. Hurd, Ph.D. God bless. All right. We'll be right back, 1-800-462-6479.
You're listening to The Ken Hamblin Show, putting rabid commie liberal dogs back in their cages.